So we're live, man. Introduce yourself. And
all right, everybody. Walter Kenneth O'Dowd. Most of my people know me as Kenny, co-owner of Fox and Parlor Salon with my awesome friend and business partner, Kara Roberson. And we're here today.
Awesome, man.
Just met Jose.
Yeah, we're here at We Just Talking here in Cital Boxing. We're just going to get into why you got into hairstyling and just your journey to getting where you got.
Yeah.
And a bunch of other stuff, current topics, weird topics.
Whatever.
We just want to, that's why it's called We Just Talking.
We're just talking.
So how'd you get into hairstyling?
God, I don't even know. I mean, I'm from Portland, Oregon. To be honest, I was definitely involved with a slightly rougher crowd.
Okay. Up
there. I took a real hard look at my life and realized that I needed to make a change, and I didn't know what that change was going to be.
Yeah.
Like, I knew I had to do something completely different. And a friend brought up that she could see me doing hair, you know, like, oh, we gotta hit that. Yeah. Hit all
we gotta, we gotta all pause a little bit.
Yeah. But yeah, so, you know, it's just one of those things. At first I thought it was just gonna be a job, something to, you know, make some cash. I could see myself doing it. I've always been good with my hands, always been good with people. I was kind of like the stylish guy out of the group, you know, and I was like, all right, I'll give it a whirl. And next thing you know, I moved down to San Diego. Started school in 2008, and first when I walked in, I was like, this is gonna work. And next thing you know, I loved it. Like,
yeah.
It wasn't just like just a job to me. It started becoming a career, passion, hearing other people's stories. And the freedom behind doing hair is what really got me into it. It's like being able to be creative and make my own schedule, do what I want, and kind of go from there.
Nice. How was the school process?
I mean, school was awesome. Like, I dropped out of high school, like, barely into my sophomore year. I've never been an academic. Like, I mean, I definitely did well when it came to testing, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Like, you put me in a confined curriculum.
Yeah.
No. Like, you tell me where to be, what time to do this.
Yeah.
I have a problem with authority.
This has been good for you because you build your schedule, right?
Oh,
you
totally.
Get to create what times you're open. So, I'm the same way.
Yeah.
I'm totally the same way. I mean, I went to school and finished, but I was the same way. I didn't like people telling me how, when. So when I became a trainer and I was in these big gyms, they were still telling me when to do stuff, taking half my money.
Yep.
You know, and then you start realizing, like, dude, why am I giving people money? Like, this is stupid.
Well, when you're working for someone else, you're working towards their dream,
not
yours.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, that being said, that was the first school I actually graduated early. I attended, I stayed late, I was just
You're motivated.
I was motivated, I was hooked. Then I got into the industry. I worked for a salon in North Park for a while, and I created a great relationship with them. They're absolutely awesome, got me a lot going, and it just got to a point where I got that realization where I was making somebody else money.
Yeah.
Which that's great, but it was time to make a change.
Change, absolutely.
You know? Yeah, and then next thing you know, I left. I had no idea what I was going to do. No clue. I had like maybe 2 months worth of savings.
Yeah.
With my lady at the time, she's like, what are you doing? You quit? You had no idea like where you're going? I'm like, I don't know.
But sometimes those risks are worth it, right? Like you have to take certain risks.
You got to take the risk. There's a lot of Top Ramen involved.
Top Ramen's the go-to, right?
Yeah.
Everyone says Top Ramen.
Yeah, Top Ramen.
I'm going to tell you the truth. I've been broke and homeless, and I never ate Top Ramen. I hate Top Ramen, dude. You know what it was? It was a psychological thing. Like, I'm not broke.
I'm not doing Top Ramen.
Yeah. Like, it was just more of like, put it in your mind that you're not.
I mean, to be honest, I did spaghetti. Yeah. I mean, it's still pretty cheap. It's still,
you got to go for the fast. The Mexicans have rice and beans.
Yeah.
That thing holds you down, man.
Yeah, that'll keep you going.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And then when you got finally to that goal, when you were like, this is what I want to do, did you find the partner immediately, or was it a goal where you wanted to go on your own?
You know, to be honest, like, people ask me, like, how did you decide to create a business and, you know, what went to that? It just kind of happened. You know, I was working for this girl, Candace, and it's in the space that I now co-own with Kara. She was running the spots in this loft downtown. It's off the beaten path. It's on the fourth floor. You know, it's like in this weird area. And she kind of saw it, you know, as a spot to do hair, but not this big vision.
Yeah.
And, you know, I really looked at it as the space that just could be something.
Yeah.
And she told me she was moving up to Portland, which is kind of like ironic. I moved from Portland to something, she's moving to Portland. And so I was working in the space, and next thing you know, she just kind of pulled the plug. She's like, hey, you know, the space is not going to be here unless you guys want to take it over. And you know, she kind of put it in this instance with the stylist where it's like, do you want to own it? Do you want to own it? And we were all kind of like battling towards it. And then next thing you know, I'm sitting down with Kara and we're like, why don't we just do this together? Like, kind of split the burden a little bit.
Yeah.
No idea what we're doing. I mean, no professional background. I mean, yeah. I have a little background in business, but it's a much different business.
Yeah.
And, you know, it just, our business plan was like literally a Pinterest board of like, this is how we want the place to look cool.
Yeah.
That was pretty much it. Next thing you know, we're doing it. My lady, like, you know, she believes in me, but at the same time, she's also the realistic, like, balance to me. You know, she makes sure that she pulls me back like,
from,
you know,
from the dreams and stuff.
And, to be honest, there's definitely like a couple months where like I was putting money in the business and not into like our house.
Yeah.
You know, I was floating stuff around here and there.
Yeah.
And, you know, next thing you know, the business just started happening.
Yeah.
Like people started following, people were into it. I started posting things about like how stoked we were before it was even a thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, one thing led to the next and Kara and I are just making it happen and people are wanting to work with us. People from the previous salon started following us over.
Yeah.
Then we got this huge following from people down at Paul Mitchell, the school, people that are just digging what we're doing.
Yeah.
And I think the reason why is we're kind of trying to shift the industry in the sense that really empower the stylists and make sure they're making the bread.
Yeah.
Like a lot of other salons out there, which they got their business, they're doing it. But the way I look at it is our stylists are, they're the celebrity, they're the star.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, I think they should get paid as such.
Yeah.
So like, I'd rather capitalize off a whole ton of people rather than just like,
Just the one.
Yeah. You know?
And so, that's what I got from your guys' page.
Yeah.
Like, everyone has their artsy pictures. Like, you guys are really focusing on the stylist. Like, when you look at your guys' page, it looks that way. Like, it's not just, I'm this person and you're the, like, you're not.
I'm not above anybody.
Yeah, like, you're not putting that, it didn't feel that way. It felt like you guys were a really good group. Everyone has their own style, which gives people the option to choose, and the place looks very artsy. Like when I was watching it looks artsy, you know, so it gives you that feel like there's more to it, that you're not just gonna get a regular haircut or a regular it just seems more, it seems like you want to go to that place, you want to say I cut my hair there. That's the vibe that I got from your guys' pages,
and we share that mentality, you know. We share that everybody shines, you know.
That's the first thing that everyone I shines. Caught from like even walking in this space. Excuse, what was your name again, man? I'm sorry.
Julio. We're gonna get a fancy we're gonna take your guys' motto and now put it to ours. His name is Julio.
This is Julio.
We're going to take your guys' motto and be RT.
Welcome to the gym.
Yeah. But, I mean, we were talking a little bit before we got on the air here. And, you know, I saw this, like, tight-knit, like, environment in here.
Yeah. Just
talking about the one-on-one experiencing with your training and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, that's really where we come from.
Yeah.
Is we've seen these big conglomerate companies come out there and, you know, they're crushing it. It's rad. But you go to their events and their training, and it's you and a pile of people.
Yeah, you don't get to learn from
like,
that.
Maybe if you grab a little bit here and there, but with the way we educate, you know, it's 5 to 10 people at a time, like max. And like, we're just being real. I'm not teaching them a system. I'm not teaching them like, you know, this direct way that came from someone above. I'm like, look, this is just what I've learned over the past few years. This is what works for me. Maybe you can do it a little differently.
Yeah.
And make it your own.
I see, I'm the same way with them. I'm like, you can learn anything you want from me, but make it yours, man.
Yeah.
Make it yours. Do not make it yours.
Well, it's an art.
You know, absolutely.
Like, even when you, like, I don't know much about boxing.
Yeah.
But from what I understand, a lot of it's a mentality.
Yes.
You know?
Everything,
And I think that goes for anything.
Anything.
It doesn't matter whether you're an artist, whether you're a businessman, you know, craft, whatever it is.
Absolutely.
It's a state of mind that, you know, you're coming from, that you can learn all these tools, but unless you put it in your own way.
Yeah.
You're just going to be another cog in the wheel.
And then what I've learned is from becoming the employee to becoming the owner, it's a different shift. You got to start being more methodical, more in a whole different, more visionary than just being the employee. Before, is I just did.
Yeah.
That's what I do. Boom, go in there, I get paid, I'm out.
Yep.
When I'm here, it's like, now it's my name. Because the gym is my actual name. It's my actual family's last name.
Yeah.
Which now it's like, what's my name? It's my brand. Like, how do
it's
I...
who you are.
Yeah. Everything that represents this is me.
Yep.
So even in the design of the process, I put my culture up. My mom is Yaqui Indian. My father and them are Mexica Indian. So I put our birthday in our language and Nahuatl and numeric stuff. Like, I try to let people see who I am. Because I look like a tough guy, according to everyone.
Yeah.
So when I go there, yeah, like when you see someone, I'm from the hood.
Yeah.
And I'm designing stuff like that. I built all the, everything you see in here. And then they see, like, oh shit, there's an artsy side to this motherfucker. He's not just
the street like,
guy that's gonna punch me in the face. Yeah, you know what I mean? So, but I do understand why they thought that.
Yeah.
So now I'm like, well, let me show them who I really am. Even my gear to go with pink and black alligator.
Yeah.
So like even that, I was like, I'm going to go with pink and black gator. Yeah. Like, you know, in boxing, you don't see that type of stuff because it's always this macho stuff, especially in my culture.
Yeah.
You got to be macho. You're Mexican. You got to be. And it's like, you really don't. I'd rather be smart.
Yeah.
Like I try to tell the kids I teach, don't be a stereotype. You don't have to work in construction. You don't have to be a cook. You don't have to pick shit. You don't have to.
Yeah.
Be what the fuck you want. You want to be a fucking violinist? Then be a violinist. Because in what we grew up, let it be the day that you saw a kid playing a violin. You're not going to pick on him, Julio?
Oh, yeah.
When we were kids. You know what I mean? Yeah. But that's the mentality they build on you.
Yeah.
And what's crazy was that when we were kids, they told you, oh, white people are bad. Black people are bad. So they try to circle you.
They try to put
you in a box of be Mexican. But something I'm going to tell everybody, the fucked up part is when you're Mexican and you open a business, every Mexican is talking shit about you. And it's like, they don't support. So I'm like,
it doesn't make sense.
I've had more support.
You're supposed to be built into this community.
Exactly. Why isn't the community here?
Yeah.
And then I started seeing, like, my clients, I have lawyers, doctors, they're white guys. And I seen how fucking supportive they are, how respectful they are. Like, when I asked you to come here, immediately was like, absolutely. And I've asked other boxing friends, that because they have a name now? Oh, man, you know, it's like, yo, for real?
My friend recently just shared with me, you know, to be honest, I've been going through, like, these waves.
Yeah.
You know, like, I had this major shift back in April. It was around my birthday.
Yeah.
I was looking around me. I had 20 people with me down in Mexico, whatever. And, like, I just realized I had this awesome community of people.
Yeah.
And so I started really striving hard and, like, really crushing and trying to get all these goals. And then I hit a point, like, within these past couple of months where I felt like, all right, well, we did all that. Now what? And then what I realized is it's a shift on, you know, who you're surrounding yourself with and getting those people that support you to just only be around those people, you know? And, like, speaking of those people that are supporting or aren't supporting, but, like, you know, like me, I saw you were trying to create something.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to create something, and immediately we have something in common. Completely. And it's like, when you're around other people that are just 100% going for it, when they put all their chips on the table for what they believe in and what they go for, like, it's contagious.
Yeah.
Like, it's something that you just can't help but want to be around.
Yeah, absolutely. Because that's what I started noticing. I was like, well, I'm hanging around business owners. Yeah. Well, you take that philosophy where people tell you, if you hang around, you're your five closest people.
You're the mirror.
So you're trying to, you know, start hanging out with business owners and trying to pick their brain and trying to see anybody that's successful. I always pick their brain. I'm like, oh, so what was this? And how'd you get here? And and they're always, but I've noticed, like, real, like, some of my clients are real successful, like wealthy guys. Don't give you the secret. They want you to figure it out.
Oh, every time.
Every time. They give you enough, but they never.
They sprinkle these little, little breadcrumbs. And
they never, but I feel like that's the way to learn.
Well, I think the reason behind that is, just like you're saying, that's the way that you learn. You know, that's the way that you really, you're breeding success. You know, it's one of those things, like, if someone just hands it to you, then
you're not going to take it for granted.
You're going to take it for granted. You're not going to take it super seriously, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like when you have those struggles and you're going through it and then you have that aha light that worked.
Yeah.
You're like, hell yeah.
Yeah. And see, and that's what I tell them all the time. I want to give my clients that ah moment. You know, when you convince them of this move did this or this punch did, and they finally go, and you're like, they got it.
Yeah. Doesn't it give you, like, goosebumps?
It's like, I got it. Because I know, like, your craft is an art, and I believe mine is an art. I always tell people, absolutely, my shit's an art. And I feel like when you give that person that look and you nipped it on the butt, what they wanted, and you see that face, you know you did. Yep. You know you did it.
No, you know you changed somebody. It's just like this ripple effect. Yeah. It's like, you know, what else are we here for other than to touch and create legacy, create passion create other inspiration.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, otherwise you're moving along.
Yeah.
Whereas like, if you have that moment where you connect with someone that you're teaching,
yeah,
you know that that's going to change it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, that's going to light a fire, then they want more.
Yeah.
They get more and more hungry for it.
And we've done that here at this gym. You know, I've had some kids like that completely have came back and been like, you changed my life completely. Like,
yep,
they're a whole different human beings. They mimic some of my tattoos.
Yeah.
And you're sitting here like, what? Like, the kid's like, can I tattoo that? Like, he wanted to put the gloves I have on the thing. And they're not the best gloves in the world, no, tattooed-wise. I'm like, they're pretty crappy, man. Like, I don't think you want to do these. Like, put some. But he's, yep, like, no. He took a picture and came back, like, about a week later. He's like, look, man. And he had the same tattoo, man. And I'm sitting here like, oh, like, that opens your eyes to see, yeah, how much influence and power you've created.
Oh, yeah.
Not necessarily monetarily, but just inspiring people and pushing people. And that, at the end, I've always told them, I want people to remember my name.
Yep.
I want my name to be remembered. Like, if I die tomorrow, I want you to tell your kid who I really was.
Yeah.
How influential I was. How, that's more of a drive to,
well,
me.
I think that creates more value that is going to bring monetary, yeah, value. You know, I had someone once tell me, you know, money, it's energy.
Yeah.
You know, and don't get me wrong, we all would love to have a big bankroll. Like, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But what I learned is, like, once you started putting your, like, true, like, soul into what you're doing,
yeah,
the monetary, it comes to follow. And then people just choose to organically spread it, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, they support you just because of what you stand for. You know, yeah, it's like, you're supporting this as an art. You're looking at each person as like, dude, you have the option to crush this,
yeah,
at the upteenth level.
Yeah. Like, Julio's been training under me. And I tell him all the time, man, like, dude, like, I get on him sometimes. And I'm like, it's because I see so much of who I was when I was starting.
Yeah.
I just see so much. And I just want him to avoid the fuck-ups that I get. So I'm like, always like, hey, don't do this.
How long have you been in this for? Like, since you're
shit,
a kid?
I started boxing when I was 5.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
But actually being a trainer about, I want to say, like, 15 years, like, actually training somebody.
Yeah.
And I'm 33.
Okay.
So I'm the youngest, one of the youngest trainers in San Diego. At the level I'm at, I'm probably the youngest in San,
yeah,
Diego that has done what I've done.
Yeah.
The accomplishments I've done and where I've gotten to. But I always try to tell him, I'm like, look, man, don't do this, don't do that. Because, like, I see it, and I sometimes feel like, am I going too, like, not hard per se, because he never takes what I say personal, like,
no,
I'm being,
yeah,
a,
yeah,
dick. But it makes me think, like, is he, like, I don't want to feel like
is
I'm
grabbing.
Yeah, like, I just don't want to offend him. Like, I don't want you to think that,
you know,
you're not competent.
I don't think you're ever offending. For one, like, when I'm doing education within my classes, I used to be really hard on myself. Like, I'm like, am I telling them the right advice? Am I this? And it's like, at the end of the day, if someone has already chosen you to train with you, they already, like,
they're
buying what you're selling. Like,
yeah,
they're in it. You know, they're invested. And it's like, if you can give them whatever it is to go on the path that led better rather than the one that you kind of hit end on and then have to take a U-turn.
Yeah.
You gotta take it.
Yeah, man. It's been quite a journey, like, seeing people that pick up stuff from me.
Yeah.
But, like, when me and him talk, like, I talk a lot of shit. When I'm boxing, I'm the shit-talking type. I'm, like, I'm a Floyd Mayweather, Conor McGregor type. I'm talking shit the whole time. But I tell people, shut me up.
Yep.
Shut me the fuck
Prove
up.
Me wrong.
Just shut me up. And when you shut me up, then I'm going to shut up.
Yeah.
I can't do nothing else. Like,
yep.
But if you can't shut me up, you can't whine and complain that I talk too much shit.
Yeah.
Get in there and shut me the fuck up. Like, I've always, that's how I've been in the gym. And I'm like, anybody, whatever. I'm not afraid to lose. That's the thing. Like,
yeah,
that's what's made me successful. I don't have the fear to lose. Like, I don't believe.
Well, that's the difference.
I don't believe in losing
people and unsuccessful people.
I believe it as a lesson.
Exactly.
Learning. I don't believe it's losing. I
all
believe
failure
it's,
ever is, yeah, is experience.
It's experience, exactly.
That's all it ever is.
Like, and I've gotten my ass whooped a ton of times. But never changed my persona. What it made me was like, you won't do that shit again.
Yeah.
Like, if you hit me with a punch, you won't hit me with that fucking punch
not
again.
Not that same one.
It's not happening again. And I really focus on that. Because when I get in the ring, me and him were tripping once because he finally saw a video of me and him sparring. He's like, dude, this shit looks super slow. And I'm all, because it is super slow. I'm just giving you the facade that it's faster than what you think.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm making certain punches seem fast in my timing. But when you actually see it in video, it's super slow. Like, yeah. You trip out, like,
oh, yeah.
The fuck? I was like, it's not, I make it this slow. That's what these guys don't understand, why I last so long when we're sparring. I'm not shit. I don't do shit.
Yeah.
I eat horrible. I'm probably going to get a heart attack in a few months. You know, I'm like,
you
shit.
Need to go by your wellness center.
Right.
Like, taking some of that stuff.
So what I tell them is that I mentally put myself in a space when I get in that ring and don't believe it's going to be any different.
Yeah.
I already whooped your ass before we went in the ring. Like, you know, I believe that. Like, I really believe that.
And I think that goes the same with any business or anything that you go for, whatever goal, whatever vision, whatever you're heading at, you know. You have to look at it as like, well, I've already done that.
Yeah.
But it's like getting those little steps ahead of time.
Yeah.
You know, it's all just a state of mind.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I when we first opened the salon, I came at it like on social media, all this stuff. I'm like, we're crushing it. This is awesome. We're slammed. This is the best place you could ever be.
Yeah.
So on and so forth. And it wasn't like just a sell. It was, I believed it.
You believe that?
You know, maybe it was just me and my partner for the first few months. Yeah. And like, we didn't have much going on, but I was like,
but it's how you feel, right? Because there's moments where I'm like, fuck, I'm so broke. What's going on? And I was like, you know something? Fuck it. I'm going to be happy. And then the fucking clients just start coming in. And you're like, what the fuck?
Once you shift that mindset.
And that's, you know, manifesting the vision. You know what I'm saying?
People feel that. Then
you manifest what you really want.
It's an energy.
And you really do it once you become, like, responsible. I'm going to say responsible of something. Completely. Because Julio, what do you do? You're an engineer. But what's the things you...
The windmills, wind turbines.
The wind turbines. He's an engineer for that.
Oh, okay.
So he has to lead, but you know what I'm saying? When you were like, fuck, I need to catch up.
Yeah.
He still has to manifest that energy to get that whole team going through an email.
Yeah.
Like, how hard is that? Like, we at least get to speak.
Yeah.
You have to send an email and, like, convince these people they can get it done.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely. How hard, you know, when I saw that, I was like, damn, like, my boy over here got to send emails. He don't even get to... Like, I'm terrible at explaining shit in text.
Yeah.
I'm Mexican. I can spell like 5 words probably. So half of the other shit just sounds.
I got me here.
I think he miyagi's like, hey, so he sends me the text and I have to figure it out.
Yeah.
Is that a treasure map?
You have to like decipher it.
Yeah.
It's like, I gotta get my decoder.
Is this code? He's all like if I'm selling drugs and shit, I'm like, yo.
I think he's miyagi me a lot of times.
Oh yeah, he's like, is this a riddle? Am I supposed to figure this out?
Yep.
But that motivates me because I'm like, damn, he doesn't even get to like speak. He has to do this all. Like, these people don't even get his energy.
Yeah.
But he is.
A lot of people didn't even see me.
Like, he's manifesting that energy. He's putting it out there. You know,
it's there whether you're speaking or not.
Yeah.
You know, it's a way of being.
Yeah.
Like, I've been getting like super hippie with just everything in life lately.
But that's your Portland roots, though.
Dude, I can't even, like, I've never really been that person.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden there's just been undeniable things that have happened within the past, like, year.
Yeah.
And I'm like...
Well, like, I also saw on your page, you and some of your buddies were helping out. You guys were in Smart and Final.
Totally.
Is that from a past experience you had that you came from nothing and you felt like, time to like...
So like a little more on like my background. I didn't come from like a rough family. Yeah. Like I grew up upper middle class, like somewhere in between. There's definitely lower points when I was younger, but I mean, I lived well when I was young. My father passed away when I was 14 though. And I was used to a certain state of living.
Yeah.
I was used to like, this is how we did things.
Yeah.
When that went away, I lost not only a father figure, but I lost like, you know, this financial support that I was used to. And I was like, well, I'm going to make this happen one way or another.
Yeah.
So then I found myself in a rougher crowd where we were definitely doing a lot of dumb stuff.
Yeah.
And
everyone did that in high school.
Oh, we all did it. You know? And, I mean,
high school were your fucked up years. Like, if you didn't fuck up in high school, you're weird.
That's when I started my first business. You know?
Yeah.
Like, if it was successful.
Your first business.
It was a successful business.
I think we've all been that route.
Yeah, we've all been there.
We've all been there. I got some bullet holes.
That's the first point of entrepreneurship.
I have my war scars from my first business.
But... I mean, it wasn't like, it became rough, and I made it rough, and I had a great like network of friends. We were awesome, but we were just doing dumb shit.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like one thing after another, and it's just like all of a sudden you're looking, and you're like, this isn't gonna work. This isn't gonna last long. Like, I'm not gonna last long. I'm not gonna be around here that much longer.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, it's that switch that you know, you gotta, it's all up to you. Yeah. You know, like I was a high school dropout, probably the network of everybody that knew me from like my high school and all the people up in Portland. If you would have asked anybody like when I was like 17, if I would be doing anything, they'd be like, hell no.
Yeah.
But the reason why that's so important to anybody is like, whether or not you're in a bad place, a good place, but as long as you want to change and you want to shift it,
yeah,
it's a mindset.
And it has to be your choice.
And it has to be your choice.
Yeah.
That's also motivation, you know?
You know, it's just, it's really shifting the way that you view things from the like, well, I could if I did this. I could if this happened this way. To being like, I am.
Yeah.
This will. This has. Like, it's shifting that state of mind.
Yeah, because a lot of things when I was growing up was, I hope. A lot of things was hope.
Yeah.
I hope I make it, or one day I might have. It was a lot of wishing and hoping.
Yeah.
And never doing. Well, like, in my culture, like, when you're coming up, they don't teach you about opening bank accounts or checking your credit, or they don't teach you these type of things. So when you get to the fucking real world, you're like, what the fuck? Like, you know, it's a fucking, and I'm sure it's for every culture, because high school should be teaching that.
Yeah.
I believe that should be something that they put in
the
school,
foundation of it.
Of school. Like, teach me how to be an adult, motherfucker. I don't care about Christopher Columbus. He ain't gonna pay my bills. Like, and it's, you realize that when you get our age, and you're like, fuck, none of that shit, nothing that I did in fucking social studies, science class, history class has helped me at all.
I learned a lot more once I got
out of high school. Yeah.
Like, I learned it very quick.
It was like, you better learn that.
You gotta learn it.
You gotta learn it. But you know, that's crazy, right?
In a lot of other cultures, like, you know, I have a lot of clients from all over the world.
Yeah.
You know, like Europe, whatever. And, you know, in other cultures, especially in Europe, being a tradesman is really respected, and it's taught at a young age.
Yeah.
It's like, you got a craft that you're good at, run with it.
Yeah.
You know, and then you just learn specifically on that subject.
Yeah, because in Mexico, the same way.
And like, that's reality.
You see shoe shiner, from small things, from shoe shining to mechanics, to building things out of wood and stuff. Like in Mexico, you still find furniture that's handmade. You still find things that are handmade, because like you said, they don't want to let go of that tradition. They'll pass it on and they'll pass it on.
Yeah.
And in America, we kind of, our tradition is TV. It's sad, but it's TV.
Totally.
It's now, what's on TV?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's the new thing. I'm going to be that.
Yeah.
Then we see the next thing on TV. Well, I'm going to be that. You know, because when, how old are you?
I'm 28.
28, 33, close.
Yeah, ish.
So when we were growing up and we were watching TV, we had shows like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, was still a little bit more family orientated and still gave you more. Now you see the shit that's on now, like the Kardashians, the Real Housewives of blah, blah, blah.
Reality.
And like, it's, like you're giving this false sense to these kids that's what they're supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what I mean? Unfortunately, we all are raised by television, even from our era, because that's what we watch. That's what you learn.
Totally.
That's what you're mimicking. Like what we were talking about, other states and other parts of the U.S. You go to the Midwest and the South, they grow up with football.
Yeah.
Like that's their shit.
That's your religion.
So that's how they get these kids to grow up and start thinking of football, and then you get these big ass corn-fed dudes playing awesome football. But that's their religion. When you come here to California, it's such a hotbed of fucking cultures that you start learning, like, oh shit, you do what? And you start seeing all the mixes and stuff. Did that influence your style from watching European stylists? Did you even research
worldly
stuff, or was it just you?
I definitely, like, I've always been a person that sounds so self-centered, but like, I always just focus on what am I creating, who am I gonna be?
Yeah.
Like, don't get me wrong, I've been influenced by people here and
there.
But you know, even when it came to sports, you know, I used to race cars, I've done football, I've done all kinds of different sports and whatnot, but I was never much of a watcher. I never paid attention to like what was playing on TV.
Yeah.
It was just, I practiced, and then I brought it to the field.
Yeah.
Like, or to the track, or whatever it was. And it was the same kind of thing when it came to this business and doing hair. Like, the whole thing that I feel like we're trying to shift a little differently is that there's no right way to do anything.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, it's just make it your own. Like, I definitely was taught on a very technical level on how to do what I do, but I break every rule in the book.
Yeah.
You know, and I tailor it to my own kind of way.
Absolutely.
You know, I bring it to my own reality. I have that foundation of, like,
fundamentals, but then you took it to your talent group. Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm sure it's the same with boxing.
Yeah,
you know, it's like,
because we all get taught fundamentals, but it's how you want to create after.
Absolutely.
I always tell these guys, look, man, I'm giving you a blank canvas and some paintbrush. Create. I'm guiding you. I'm not forcing you to. I'm just guiding. Paint your own picture. Like,
I'm showing you the toolbox.
Yeah.
It's up to you.
Yeah. And you do want to teach him the right tools, because you don't want to send a carpenter with welding tools. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Especially not in a sport where you're getting punched in the fucking face.
Yeah.
Because in our sport, that's the concept. The concept is to hurt the person in front of you. So it's not a sport in a sense. It's not football. It's not baseball.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're dangerous, but the concept isn't to hurt.
Yeah, the concept is to
get points.
To get points. In this combat, it's, I want to fuck you up, I'm going to break your face, I'm going to murder you. Some people think crazy shit.
See, mine's a little different.
Yeah.
My concept is to make you feel great.
Great, yeah.
Amazing. But the consequence is, if you don't know what you're doing, you make someone feel terrible.
Terrible. Well, I've seen some
and that's worse than getting punched in the face. So, you got to wear it.
Yeah, for a while.
You get a punch in the face, you can at least walk it off.
Like, everyone's gotten a fucked up haircut.
Yeah.
When you're cheap, like you're trying to save money, is the worst thing. Do not fucking,
for all
be a cheapskate on your hair.
Yeah, don't be a cheapskate on your hair.
Definitely.
If you're not trying to get punched in the face, get trained by this guy. Believe all these things. Share this Facebook Live.
Because I was younger, like, you know, I was a little more on the broke side. So I was like, fuck it, I'm just going. I went to these Asian salons. I don't want to be the racist person.
Nothing against Asians.
No, but, you know, instead of $5 ones. Yeah, come on now. You're paying
$5. It's cheap, yeah.
So I went in there and, you know, I was like, oh, can you do a fade? You know, at the time, it was just a low skin fade and just. No,
like it's simple. Yeah,
simple.
Just do it.
I came out with like a fucking Jewish hat looking ball of hair. I wanted to kill somebody. I was like, I'm going to kill all of you.
So you went to an Asian place and came out with the Jewish haircut?
Yeah. Well, like the thing is just looked like the little Jewish hat. Like that's how much hair
they
she left on top.
Faded it all
she
the
like,
way
I was like, it wasn't even a fade. Like, you could see the line. I was like, oh my God. The good thing about being a guy is
wear
always shave it.
Yeah, shave it.
You could just always shave it. You can just shave the shit out of that bitch and then it grows even.
Yep.
So that's my go-to move.
Yeah.
But having good haircuts does change the way you feel, way you walk. Like, you're just a whole different human.
I mean, sometimes I even forget. You know, it's like I do it day in and day out, and it's like the common joke, like, within the industry, I think, is like, us that work behind the chair, we honestly don't get our hair done that often. I get my haircut once every couple months.
Yeah.
Like, I kind of like the involvement of it, but... You know, when I get that fresh haircut, when it's been like a couple months, I'm like, let's go out tonight, babe. Like, let's go do something.
Yeah.
Like, I want to put on my nicest clothes, and I just want to cruise. Like,
what I liked about what you were doing and what you're teaching is teaching how to do the look after the salon.
Oh yeah.
So I really paid attention to that, which was really dope. I was like,
yeah, because
most people don't tell you
it.
That you can never like reproduce or recreate what they just did the first time.
Yeah, dude, it was so hard.
It never looks the same. So I really liked when you put that. You were like,
make it to where
I educate where you could take it home and do it. And I was like, that's dope. Like. No one tells you that. They're like, oh, good, you want some product? And they put it in, and then it's like, all right, you pay them, and you're out.
I think that's what can, like, set any stylist off apart.
Yeah.
It's like, we're, like, artists and magicians when it comes to hair, but if you toss them home and then it doesn't look the same when they come back to see you.
Yeah.
It never does.
It never has the same exact. It never has the same like exact look. Like I try to duplicate it every time.
When I,
like,
I get out the barber, it looks great, and then when I do myself.
Tell us your next barber. So I have you know those window car mounts for your cell phone, like the suction cup up to the window.
Yeah.
I have one of those in front of my station. So I put it on the station. I tell my client, I'm like, hey, put your phone up there, hit it on record. You can record what I'm doing with your hair as far as the styling. Then you can replicate that, take that home.
See, that's dope.
That's like, pretty.
That's clever.
It's simple.
Yeah, it's clever. Because I don't see what he's fucking doing.
You're just,
his hands are just going through it.
Yeah, it's happening all fast.
Yeah, so, and do you mainly do men's or women? Or you just whoever comes in?
I mean, I definitely have a widespread clientele. Like, I focus mainly on my male clientele and then, like, women's color. I definitely do women's haircuts and stuff like that, but... It's just one of those things that I figured out that I enjoyed those aspects the most. I tried to spread myself super thin.
Yeah.
I was like, I could do everything.
Yeah.
And then I couldn't do everything.
And then, so I have curly hair.
Yeah.
But I've cut it short enough where I could do like a comb over or where like a stay, but it's like the urban comb over.
A little bit.
You know, like the urban style. It's more faded, edged up. It's more, so I could tame it. But my hair is fucking curly. Like, if I let it grow, it's a fucking fro.
Yeah, it's going
to
go.
So straight. It's always hard for me to, like, I don't want the typical fucking haircuts no more. Like, it's, it bothers me. Like, I don't like, I just always go to the same shit.
Another, you don't
want
like,
I don't
want to
be the copy of a copy of a copy. Because that's what you end up looking like. And it's like, when you get it, they're like, oh, everyone's doing that. And it's like, God damn it. Yeah, so I go shave my fucking head because...
You know, I think that, don't get me wrong, I definitely do plenty of haircuts that are on trend that you see people with, for sure. But my core clientele, my core people, like, they sit in my chair and I give them their haircut.
Yeah.
You know, like, that's what I push anybody to do in my salon.
See, to me, I would be like, if I went to someone like you, it'd be like, well, cut my hair.
Exactly.
Just cut my hair. You know what you're doing. I don't know hair. How can I tell you what the fuck my hair should do?
Exactly.
And I think that's the problem with a lot of people. Let the artist do their thing. Let them do their thing, man. Like, watch. Yeah. You'll be happy.
And the results are a lot better.
Yeah, you'll be happy.
Every time the results are better. You know, that's a majority of my clientele. They sit in the chair and I ask them what they want to do and they just kind of laugh. They're like, shut up, dude. Like, you know what you're doing. Yeah,
and that's what you're supposed to give that respect to that craft. Like, hey, you know what you're doing. You know hair. Yeah. I don't know hair. I know how to...
I'm gonna come here for a training class and be like, okay, so this is how I want to be trained today.
Oh, you'd be shocked how many people do that.
Oh, my God.
You'd be shocked at how many people come and tell me how I should train them. Like, oh, you should do this and you should try this. Like, oh, shit, huh? Yeah. Like, how many people have you trained? They're like, oh, nobody. I'm like, oh, cool then. I tell people, if you don't like the way I train, I'll send you to other gyms. I'll give you names of other gyms around here. I'm not here to compete with these guys because I'm not competing. I'm me. You're coming here to see my brand and my team that's coming off of my brand, off of my school.
Yeah.
You know, so they're going to teach similar with their own flavor, but it comes from the same school.
Yeah.
They're going to have similar philosophies, similar mentality on how we do things. Like my mom, when I was growing up, like I said, we were pretty poor, but my mom always said, we all eat. Everyone ate. We had friends over and everyone ate.
Everyone eats.
So that's my rule here. Everyone eats, man. Like, no need for greed. No need for nothing. If you want to do this, I'm more than open. But then a lot of people have taken my kindness for a weakness in a sense.
Yeah.
But what I tell everybody is like, they fucked me over, but I learned from that. I learned from it. It's cool. Like, it's a part of growing.
I think that's like also a concept that we all need to kind of shift and figure out exactly what that means to us. Like, you know, maybe they took your stuff and ran with it, but at the same time, it's a high point of flattery.
Yeah,
you know, it's like, me, when I left the salon I was coming from in North Park, like, you know, I'd say first couple months, it was like kind of awkward, like this and that, but it's like at the end of the day, you can't help but respect somebody that's going for whatever they're trying to do.
Yeah.
Now, if they're slap copying what you're doing and just like copy and paste, it's a little tougher, but you know, it's like, anybody, like, we recently had a stylist leave us at the salon, and she was, like, I could tell that she was, like, she phrased it in this message. She was, like, trying to make sure my feelings weren't hurt and there's no bad blood. I was like, dude, go crush it. Like, you're starting your own salon.
Yeah.
That's what I did.
Yeah.
You know, you got to do it. Like, that's the natural progression. And for anybody that wants to still work with us, hell yeah.
Yeah.
But if anybody wants to open up their own spot, I'll support them.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to be sending my clients over there.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Like when I split from my old gym.
Oh, yeah.
I told them, like, look, man, you did this. You cut all my hours. I can't survive with what you're doing. So I have to go do my own thing.
Yeah.
But I told them, we sat down in a meeting and I told them there was no message, no email to their face.
Yeah.
I said this and I was like, if you guys still want, I can still do this one class you guys give me. If you guys want, if not, I can, we still want you. But, you know, obviously they didn't because it just kept getting awkward and awkward and awkward. Then the day I finally left, I just told them, look, guys, the guy had a history of talking shit about people that left.
Yeah.
And I said, look, man. Just don't say nothing about me. You don't got to tell him I found a better spot. Nothing. You can just say he moved on.
Yeah.
Just say those simple words. Minutes after I left, he went and told a guy that's a good friend of mine.
Yeah.
Tons of shit. So my friend's like, yo, like, you didn't even leave.
Wasn't that fuel, though?
Yeah. And then people. Wasn't that total fuel? You know what bit him in the ass? That tons of people left because they were doing that. People were just like, well, I'm going to go with him. People just started leaving them. And coming here.
When you lead with positivity, people have an urgency to follow.
You know? And I wasn't the best employee by no means. Did I do my fucked up shit there? Absolutely. But I owned the mistakes. I owned my mistakes and that. And all I said was, just don't talk bad about me. Even now, I send them people still. When I don't have people here, it's like, oh, undisputed downtown.
Yeah.
Because the trainers are my friends. I just had a problem with the with the little hierarchy, the management. Yeah. But the employees, the trainers, they're awesome to me, and they're friends of mine, and I'm still going to send people there because it is quality there. I'm not saying that it's not quality there. It is quality there. So if you're looking for certain specific things that we don't offer, I do send them there.
Yeah.
I'm like, hey, Undisputed, it's riding downtown, go straight down there.
Yep.
I never hate, I'm not going to because, like you said, the staff is my friend. Members, trainers, I still have friends there. So I'm not going to sit there and just like all of a sudden get all butthurt and like trashing them. And absolutely not. But like you said, that was fuel for me to when I came here, you know, and I did this.
I mean, I think that's been some of the biggest fuel in my life is when someone said I can't.
Yeah.
You tell me I can't.
Well, that's why I have this. People trip out because I have the born loser. Because everyone would call me a loser. So then when I started getting more famous in boxing, I wanted to put that. So in every picture, I stand there and see that born. Remember the one you called loser? Yeah. It's not where you wish you were.
It's that next step.
Yeah, it's like you wish you were where I was at. Because all you're doing was focusing on bringing negative to me, trying to make me feel down.
Yep.
But that's the born loser. Like people like tell them it's not because I feel like I'm a loser. It's just like I was told that growing up.
Yeah.
Oh, you fucking loser.
It's just a reminder being like.
Yeah, it's like there's your born loser. So the born loser made it. Exactly. That's where I got it. So now we're going with some randomness. What do you watch on YouTube? Just a random shit?
I watch
weird.
I can't say this. No.
Now I want to know.
No, I mean, my lifestyle, like, the reason why I got into what I do is to have freedom to do what I love. And I love off-roading. I love camping. I love getting out in the wilderness. I love traveling. I love adventure. And I mean, my lady, she gives me so much, she gives me flack. Like, she's like, what are you looking at? And I'm just like watching these YouTube videos of like these Jeeps off-roading, like out in the middle of Alaska. And I'm just like, that's gonna be so sick when I do that. Like, you know, I like setting these goals of things that I wanna get and do to like work towards. And it's like, when I get into something, I nerd out on it like
hard.
Like, I'm in a rabbit hole of YouTube videos, like, of the next one to the next one that I
want to watch. I watch animals attacking other animals. I watch the dumbest shit on YouTube. Yeah. And I sit there for hours. It's like, damn.
It's so funny how you guys are so similar, though, man. I see a lot of similarities.
Yeah, so I watch because I love camping. I want to go hunting. And I start watching these things, and I get so fucking deep into, like, this is the – I need this type of bow.
Yeah, exactly.
They're doing this, and I need this type of this. And yeah, exactly. So I'm like, I need these things.
Yeah, like, I mean, I'm driving this 4Runner right now, and it's got, like, almost 300,000 miles on it. And I mean, this thing has taken us up and down California. I've been at like 15,000 feet up in the Sequoias, and like some of the most magical moments where I got my aha that brought it back to business and back to where I want to go.
Yeah.
It's always been when I've been out there, when I've been just like by myself, like had this adventure with my buddy. And I mean, we are smashing up this dirt road, like probably should have died. But hey, I mean, we definitely should not have been driving up the road during that time. But nonetheless, we get up to the top there, and it's like there's this full moon behind us, and the sun setting right in front of us, and we're at the highest point of the park. And I'm just like, fuck, dude, life is so good. Like, I want to do this, but to the next level now.
Yeah,
and
so now I'm going to Alaska.
Yeah, now I'm going to Alaska. I'm going to get to the top of the
world. Crazy because, right, when you watch something that you want to do, I'm the type of person that wants to do it to the best. Like, okay, I need the best stuff, not because I can afford it, but I want to see how can I mimic that if I can't afford it? I don't want to die. Like, so we wanted to, I told them, hey man, I want to go hunting on my birthday.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, spring kind of sucks. The bears are little. Let's go in the fall when they're big, getting ready for, because I want to hunt a bear. I want to hunt a black bear. Okay. And I am going to eat the meat. I'm not doing it for sport or being psychotic killer.
No.
I've never done it before.
Yeah.
And I want to do a bow.
Okay.
Because I'm indigenous. And I don't want to bait.
Yeah.
I'm hunting. I'm not baiting.
Yeah.
And then hitting them. No, I got to go find them.
Yeah. You
find their trails. And then I decided to pick Montana, the most dangerous place to hunt when you're a newbie. Because they have grizzlies. They have everything in Montana. So that's my goal.
But as soon as you're the bait.
So basically, I'm going to. So it's telling
survival.
Them.
Survival of the fittest.
He just cut his hand.
I'm like, I told him, I was like, well, I want to go, you know. But as soon as I told them, I immediately geeked on researching.
Oh, yeah.
Every fucking thing.
Diving
like
down
this.
The rabbit hole.
What I need for here. What would happen if this happened? I'm all like, these attacks happen. Brandy, my girl, we were fucking sitting there because we have a cabin in Big Bear.
Okay.
And a bear walked through the backyard when she was there at 2 in the morning. So she sends me a message like, hey.
Got a bear for you.
No, she's the first thing she told me was like, hey, I just saw a coyote like the one we saw in the zoo. And I'm sitting here like, what the fuck are you talking about? I was like, those were timber wolves. They were like 5 foot tall. So I'm like, that wasn't a coyote.
Coyotes were like this.
They're little. And she was like, no. I was like, there is no wolves in California. I was like, what did it look like? And she was like, oh, it was dark. And this, I was like, that was a bear. Like, that was a bear. Like, the shape. So I send her pictures. So that's how I send her a picture when she's up there. And I was like, did it look like this?
Confirmed.
And she was like, oh, shit. Yeah. And then she walked the dog and she could see the bear poop.
Yeah.
And she's all like, oh, man, there was a bear. But we go hiking, and she, like, nonchalantly just walks. And I'm, like, with a gun. I'm, like, panicked. Like, I'm, like, look every sound. I'm sitting here doing tactical rolls. I'm, like, just freaking out. And just nonchalantly speed walking through the mountains.
Yeah.
He's facing the floor.
Yeah, I'm, like, over here.
Bear.
Like,
3 miles.
But I'm so into, like, I gotta, like... Shit could happen, man.
Oh, yeah. You're,
and so I'm so I, into, like, what the fuck? What if
you probably were, like, I feel like within my crew up in Oregon and even down here, like, I'm always, like, calculating everything.
Yeah,
like,
that's what it is.
And it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if I'm in the woods or if I'm in the city.
Yeah, I'm the same way.
Even when we're out, if we're eating dinner or if we
I'm calculating.
Have lunch,
I sit where
wherever he sits is calculated. He's like, did you check that out? I'm like, I'm just eating a sandwich. This was like, hey, check this out over here. I'm like,
or even
see that?
When I'm watching boxing, I'll see everything.
Oh, yeah, that's
people like, how'd you see that? I was like, I see everything that's going on simultaneously. Both people, their feet, their hands. I can see everything simultaneously. Yep. I'm like, oh, he just did this. If you would have done this.
I mean, I used to skateboard and wakeboard a lot when I was younger. And, I mean, it's probably the same with boxing. Like, I mean, I'd watch videos, and, like, that's how I learned to do everything that I would
and
how to
you looked for the technical part of it.
Yeah, the littlest parts.
Yeah, exactly.
It wasn't just watching the whole thing. It was, like, you know, really watching where their feet are or how they're setting up, like, whatever. And the same thing went with hair. Yeah. Same thing with even business, you know. And, like, that's what got us to our point is, like, I was like, all right, I know how to do hair. I know how to do this. Yeah. I really, like, don't understand the business, but I started following people that do.
Yeah.
And, you know, I really paid attention close and just mimicking what they're doing, creating my own flavor, my own style. And it's like, I think it comes from that that kind of ideal.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's like just nerding out on something and just looking at every single point and being like, okay, how can we adapt this to whatever situation?
Yeah. So now, how does your girl react to the boy band ass that you're probably getting thrown at? Come on, man.
This is a common question. This is a common question.
This is a common question we ask everybody because you're probably popular. You're probably, girls are like, they flirt with you. Guys flirt with you. That's what we were talking about before.
I mean, I did have this one, he's a client of mine now, but he messaged me on Instagram. He's like, yo, what's up? He's like started BSing. He's like, you want to grab a beer sometime? And I have other business owners. We always like talk about grabbing a beer or coffee or whatever. And I'm like, yeah, sure, dude, I'm down. Yeah. And I started looking through his profile. I'm like, I wonder if he thinks this is a different kind of beer that we're having.
A different kind of beer. That's a good one. Kind of beer we have.
That's a good, like,
that's the perfect way to say
start
it.
Start using that. So, what kind of
beer? Yeah. What kind of beer we have?
Anything. Oh, so what kind of coffee are we having? Is it coffee, or is it coffee?
No, but, I mean, and don't get me wrong, like, definitely, and it goes both ways. Like, my lady, like, gorgeous freaking woman, you know? And it's like, I think as a male, we're used to that kind of thing in general. Like, it's like, if you have a pretty lady, like, every guy's looking at her when you're walking around.
Yeah.
And it's almost a sense of pride for us. Whereas, like, for a woman, like, sometimes I think they could be like, get your eyes off them. You know, that kind of thing.
Well, I got sexy fat, so I got sexy fat, you know? And I'm creating bearware, so. Well, apparently I'm a bear in the gay community. I've been told this multiple times.
I also do
security at a bar. I work at CoinOp.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the owner is one of my clients here. And we're really good friends with everybody from CoinOp. But
I used to do security.
But I've worked at Brass Rail.
Oh, okay.
My friend was the guy, and I would go there when they needed an extra guard.
Yeah.
He would call me in it. And I realized two things. Not every gay dude wants to, like, is looking at you.
No.
Absolutely not.
No.
And the second thing, they're bold. They're bold as fuck. They give two fucks.
Way more balls.
Dude, they don't give a fuck. Like, I've had one really, like, movie me, like, I'm like karate chopping me, man. Like, they're just, and they do it in a friendly way where you don't get upset. Like, when you're just more open-minded, they're like, come on, man, I'm not going to.
But, like, you know, just back onto the question or whatever, like, I think she loves it. You know, I think it's one of those things that it's like, we're both a team. Like, we do everything together. You know, I think I make it abundantly clear that I got a lady, you know, engaged on Facebook. We, you know, do all that kind of stuff. And it's just like.
Were you with her when you started?
When I started the business, yeah.
But no, just hair as a hairstylist.
As a hairstylist, yeah. We actually met in the previous salon I worked for.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, so, like, we met there, and we actually, like, I mean, I saw her the first day I walked in the salon. I was like, I need that in my life. I just saw her, and, like, it was a combination thing. Not only is she incredibly beautiful, but, like, she's really good at her craft. And I saw her doing this haircut, and she was just slaying it. Like, you know, like, you nerd out on awesome boxers and whatnot like this. Like, I saw this awesome hairstylist, and, like, I'm getting goosebumps thinking about it.
Do you guys have competitions?
You want to battle?
She's way better at certain fields than I.
You want to do this?
No, and I mean, it took like a year and a half of me, like, you know, trying to say little jokes and trying to do a little something, something.
I
worked for it hard.
You were pretty hard.
A lot of patience.
You put in that work.
I remember the moment, like, I mean, she was showing me this, like, funny cat picture. And it was this, like, smash face, like, Persian cat or whatever. And I was like, that cat looks like it's saying, I want wet food. And she started dying laughing. I didn't even think it was that funny. And I was like, yes!
He was in the scoreboard.
I was like, I'm in!
He was cheering. He was like,
hey. You know, you make a girl laugh. That's how you got it.
That's great. That's great, man.
But yeah, I mean, she'll give me flack sometimes. Like, we'll be out and about. And, you know, I think it's the same in your community. It's like, When people, you know, look and follow or, you know, are into somebody, like, you know, it's cool when they see them. And, like, we'll be at a bar and sometimes, like, I'll have somebody come up and they're like, oh, are you WKO? Like, you know, I you guys are with Fox and Parlor downtown. Like, and I think she holds it as
well. I don't have that problem. I know what approaches me.
By your Instagram name?
We need to help you with that.
People be terrified of me.
You haven't seen them out. Escobar season.
Escobar, man. People go, like, around me like he's going to murder us, man. But that's why I tell them, like, it's just me trying to be me. Like, that is me. Yeah. Like, I have my own sense of fashion, whether it's weird to other people, but I own what I wear every time. Yeah. Like, I don't give a shit what nobody thinks.
Oh, you're preaching to the choir. I mean, I dress like a complete weirdo.
Like, it's just having your style just gives you that sense where people recognize, like, look, he's not a follower. He's not just a regular fucking person here. Yep. He's just doing his own thing. Like, you know, and I always...
And your own flavor.
Yeah, we always do something when we go out. And I like going to the same spots. I don't like bar hop too much. Yeah. Just because someone always tries to fuck with me. Like, say something. I don't know what it is, but they always try to, like...
Maybe it's that vibe you're getting.
Like, they're trying to test, like, because I'm a big dude, and I tell everybody, I haven't fucked up. I'm a big guy.
Yeah.
So if I beat up a small guy, I'm a dick for beating up the small guy. Yep. But if the small guy beats me up, I'm the laughing stock because the small guy beat me up. So there's no winning with me. And it's like, man, I don't like going to these places too much. So I just do the coin op, maybe a place or two in downtown. But, I mean, it's just usually me, Julio, and a couple other friends. But not,
keep it
tight, not too crazy. Not where we're like... I mean, we get pretty fucking drunk sometimes. I'm a lightweight.
You don't look like a lightweight.
Yeah, I fucking drink like 3 or 4, and I'm dancing by myself.
Yeah.
Or shadow boxing. And then we smoke. You know, I smoke some weed, and you know, I like weed occasionally.
I absolutely do.
Julio shouldn't. Julio's proven to not do that.
He just, get a little weird.
He just gets like
get
too
a little awkward.
He gets too quiet. Like,
oh, I hit a brick. Like, I hit a brick wall. I hit a brick wall the other time, man.
Huh?
I hit a brick wall last time.
Yeah, he was just zoned out. So we went to a Christmas party and then we left and I was like, well, let's go to the shop, man. There's some weed down. I'm gonna hit some. I'm gonna go a little relaxed. So we came here and hit it. And this motherfucker hits it to the point where he's fucking dying on me. I'm like, dude, take small hits, man. We're not in high school no more, man. He's like, and it starts choking. He's dying and shit. So I was like, hey, man, relax. I like subtle stuff. I don't want to fucking get to a point where I'm like.
Yeah, you don't want to be bored.
Like, I hate edibles.
You know, I'm kind of a person when it comes to doing anything, letting loose, having fun. I always try and stay... certain point level
ahead. Yeah,
you know,
I have
like,
to
like,
use
I just don't like being out of control. You
like,
know?
I hate edibles. They're, like, too strong. They're too strong, man. They're making them too strong. I don't like
it's
that.
Too much.
I haven't done them since I was young because of that. Like, seems like everything's getting stronger, man. Like, people calm the fuck down, man. Like, there's only so far some of us could take it. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? I've done Minecraft high as hell.
Like, I definitely can't do that.
I'm over here holding mitts. Everything looks in slow motion. But it's just like I said, it's just me. Like, I'm never going to hide anything from me. Like,
yeah, people, oh,
fuck that. That's me. I do this. Yeah. I like this. I have my own business for a reason. I want to be me.
Yeah.
I'm going to be me 100%. I yell like Samuel Jackson, but that's just my voice. Like, people are like, why are you yelling? I was like, I'm not yelling. That's just how I talk. I really am.
You got a good voice. I mean, even when you answer the phone, I called you this morning trying to figure out. I was like, man, this guy sounds good. He's going to be good on the radio.
I'm just loud all the time. I talk a lot.
He just has a different type of voice.
Like, man. I like to be me. Like, I get all weird from, like, in mystical topics of aliens and shit. With all these guys, I get on some trips. Yeah. And these guys are like, what the fuck, man? Like,
what are you talking about?
Coach is tripping. Like, I can see their face half the time.
I get the same shit. Like, my business partner, she calls me the levitator. Yeah, the levitator. So, like, back in April when this, like, you know, shit happened, we were definitely having some fun. And I just had this moment where I just, like, I found, like, the secrets to the universe. Yeah. I swear, dude, like, I freaking figured, and next thing you know,
I figured it out.
Okay, I figured it out.
I didn't talk for like 6 hours. I'm just like, I swear to God. and next thing you know, like the first thing that I said when I decided to start talking, I was like, I get it. I was like, I get it. And next thing you know, we just start crushing it, all this stuff. I started manifesting all this stuff, and I started putting this energy towards everything I was putting in. Yeah. And it was it was knowing that I could create whatever I wanted. Yeah. And as long as I knew that, it was just ridiculous. The next thing you know, I'm like, let's do this, setting all these goals. And they're like, whoa, slow down. I'm like, I'm still going.
Like, yeah, I'm still going. He's like mushing people's faces. He's like, whoa. I'm like,
That's Jose. That's Jose totally.
I'm the same way, man. I get all fucking into it. I'm like, no, we gotta do this.
That's why
these
microphones are sitting here. Yeah. Right now. That's why I'm sitting
here. Yeah, I'm like, we gotta do this shit. Yeah. And he's all like, what the fuck, man?
You know, it's all about building momentum. Yeah. And it's about building this, like, this caring energy that just absolutely keeps on flowing. And it's like, you know, you can have, like, all these, like, giant goals and visions. My homie, Chris Duncan, he's super rad dude, just crushes at everything he does. We were talking a lot about momentum. And it's like, you have this big vision, right? Yeah. You know, you have this idea, and you have these big goals. But then, like, you create these little ones that get in front of you. And once you get one, you get another, another. And you start doing it, all of a sudden.
Yeah, it starts going. It's like,
and then all of a sudden, your legs are moving. You don't even know what's happening.
Yeah, and you're just going. Like, it's like, once I get going into some shit, I'm creating this, and then I'm doing this. And I was like, we need to do this. What if we did this? Let's do a podcast. We just all like, let's do a podcast. Because all we used to do was sit in here and talk hella shit. And we're like, that'd be hilarious in a podcast. Yeah, and it was like, well, let's do this. And the first idea was that we were going to do a poker table and just all sit in and play poker.
Dude, let's do that anytime you want. I play poker like a motherfucker.
You know what I mean? So we were going to do that. That was the concept, sit and play poker and talk on the podcast and just be us. But then I was like, it's going to get boring after like the fourth show. I was like, well, let's get guests. Let's start networking and blah, blah. And as soon as we started, I was just messaging people, hey, would you consider being on this show? Would you consider being?
How'd you even, like, find me to begin
with? Well, I started doing hashtags.
Yeah.
And I think you liked one of my posts.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I went on your stuff, and I liked everything you did. And then I liked your stuff. And I was like, this is dope. This dude's pretty cool. He has style, like, it's the shit that I like. Like, we see our tattoos. We have tattoos. Yeah. And I was like, it's similar to what I do. And I was like, why don't we just like him? I liked him. And then I was like, he'd be cool for the podcast. I started seeing that shit. And then I started really watching your videos. Like I said, I watched the one where you guys were in Smart and Finals helping homeless people. And I really look at people's profile. But I don't tell them what we're going to talk about. Because I want it to come organically now. Yeah. Like, naturally when we're talking now. Because if I tell you everything on the phone, I get to know.
Yeah, it's just, you're going for a milk.
How crazy is how much we have in common from meeting the same in one day. People. Like, that. And you're like, oh shit, we have so much in common.
Oh, I see.
Of meeting each other that day. Like, we never really met before. We rarely even talked before. Yep. And you start like, damn. Because I always tell them, there's no coincidence in life.
No,
I don't believe in coincidence. Everybody was meant to be in someone's moment when they needed them. Like, I needed you at the moment, and you needed me. And that's how I believe my success or the little success I've had has came about.
Yeah.
Because I just believe that. I don't believe in coincidence. Like, I always tell them, being a teacher means you're respecting the student. Without the student, you wouldn't be a teacher. So yep. They're equal. In the, you can, without them, you couldn't consider yourself a teacher. You're not teaching.
Absolutely.
So I respect my students like if they were almost equal to me, because I'm learning how to teach better because of them.
Yep.
Because I get that opportunity to teach, you know, and I've always seen it that way. I'm very like...
You know, I have a funny story about like coincidence and like all the, you know, just the idea that there is no coincidence, that, you know, everything's fate, destiny, this and that. You know, we got all this momentum building up, and then we actually ended up getting like a couple offers spit here and there, people that wanted to invest, people that wanted to be a part of what we were doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was driving on the freeway, and next thing you know, I'm merging on the freeway, and then this was right after we got these offers and like all this stuff, and also my gas pedal gets stuck to the floor of the car, and we're just like, my car starts hauling ass. I put on the e-brake, I put in the clutch, shut off the car, and I'm like, whoa, that was weird. And then I go to re-engage it, my gas pedal got stuck again. And it was right after I just had a meeting, like talking about like the possibilities of this.
Yeah.
And then I was like, I think this is like a sign from the universe that like, I need to pump the brakes a little bit, like slow down and really evaluate what we're doing.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, like I was even, and this is like just silly story, but it's like going to the grocery store at 5 o'clock, it's usually slammed. And it's like, right as I pull up, the parking space opens after like I have this aha moment, like right in the front. And I just started dying laughing. Like, I'm just like crying laughing to myself. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Like I really believe in signs. I believe in, you know, the universe has a way of telling you things. And it's like, if you choose to look at it and appreciate it in the moment, then you start really getting it.
Yeah.
And you start pulling on it. Next thing you know, it's just like, everything is happening. We need a video being made. And like, we didn't really have the budget for it at the time. This guy gives us a call. He's like, hey, I'd love to do a video for you guys. Like, do it for our... you know, for our like portfolio or whatever. And then all of a sudden it's just thing after thing after thing.
Yeah.
That's how it goes sometimes.
Yeah, man. Yeah. It's crazy like that you see that. Like, are you like spiritual or religious? Because I think
spiritual.
Because there are two different things in my book. Let me, I'm going to just
turn this Instagram
thing again. But yeah, so. Like, do you believe in like, fucking different shit, ghosts, aliens, demons. Do you believe in that type of spiritual, or do you just believe like in more like the shaman type stuff that they
use a lot of herbs? I honestly, it's not so much like shaman or religion or anything. I just believe energy.
Yeah.
I believe human energy. I believe in purpose. I believe in people's, you know, just everybody's here for a reason. We're all here to do something and make an impact. And I think like the best religion is just do good.
Yeah.
Try and create. Like, I think the best part about owning a business or starting something or creating like a movement of sorts is the fact that you're creating something else for someone else to follow. And, you know, we have this business with, you know, four other stylists, and they're able to support their lives under that. And like, that's almost a religion to me. It's like, it's not just business. It's it's creating community. It's creating
culture.
Culture.
Total
culture.
A way of life.
A way of living.
Yeah, a way of life.
It's creating happiness. And it's like, I don't pray to anything. I just believe in good energy and good, good things.
I feel we have our own culture here. It's
I feel the same way. But I always tell people, like, I believe in nature. To me, nature is reality.
Oh, absolutely. Because
nature never lies. Nature doesn't lie. And I say this all the time, and I'm always going to keep saying it. You know, the lion always kills the zebra. They're never going to be friends. It's never going to be the opposite way. The zebra will never eat the lion. So nature is reality. It tells you the same thing all the time.
Yeah.
You cannot... It's never going to lie. It's undeniable. That's what happens.
Yeah.
So I believe in nature is reality. What humans decided to do is put that word in front of it. Human nature.
Yeah.
So since we can't survive in their world, we created our own. The concrete jungle, our cars, our security of homes. We have to create something to be...
of our own reality.
Exactly. On our own stuff. So we don't believe in real reality no more because we've created our own reality.
Yeah.
We've created our own shit by putting classism, racism... We've created all this shit because in nature, if we went straight to nature, color wouldn't exist because we would be the same fucking thing. It'd just be in different colors.
Yeah.
But we've created it just like we've created dogs. There's a reason they come in all sorts of fucking shape and forms.
Yeah.
Because we want them for specific shit.
Specific
and
reasons.
That's what we get them for.
Yeah.
But that's what we do with humans. We make people become specific shit because we allow that to happen. We say, these humans do this. These humans do that. And we specifically always... Stereotypes are only true because we've made them true.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because they do have a sense of truth behind them. So, but because we created it, and that's why we say human nature is different than nature. Nature is reality. That if me and you went to the woods with nothing, there's a different story.
Yeah.
Not nothing that we know would save us from that shit unless we knew how to hunt, how to survive,
how to make tools
and make all that stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah, we have created ourselves a world that's better, but then nature still reminds us that there's still nature.
Yeah.
Crime, murders, accidents, tsunamis. Nature still lets us know, motherfucker, I still run this shit. Yeah. So it's what I always tell them. I see a lot of nature shit on YouTube because I see how animals move. I see their movement. To me, it's amazing how they think, how they process. Like, we think drug is a human creation.
Yeah.
And it's not.
No.
A jaguar would go eat a leaf. This is a meat eater, a carnivore, complete carnivore, and will go eat a leaf on purpose, a leaf, to hallucinate. He hallucinates. No, it's to hallucinate. It's to trip out. You can look this up. This is a fact. So a jaguar will purposely go
a nature show.
Eat this fucking leaf
to
fucking trip out. Just to trip out. A dolphin will eat a specific fish. So drug isn't something we created. It's something we've mimicked from nature.
Yeah.
So that's where you come with the DMT, the ayahuasca, the yopo, peyote, and we enlighten. Yeah, because it's still a part of the reality of nature. Now, when we start altering it, cocaine made it our own way, it starts murdering us because nature starts letting us know. How can indigenous people from Peru and Inca eat so much coca leaves but never die?
Yeah.
But then we make it into something totally different and then people die. So we've took in what nature's given us to help us and created this thing to just destroy the mind, destroy vision, destroy everything, and keep us on this zombie mode. Like, there's no reason for water to have fluoride, but we still put it in there.
Still is in there.
There's no reason for it. It's unnecessary, but we do it.
Yep.
We do things that are unnecessary and keep harming each other. And the only thing that I feel has released some of us is that we believed in ourselves and our creations.
Oh,
and
you believe in something bigger.
And something that we've created. Like you said, we've created this whole business, religion, culture, because we chose to be open-minded.
Yeah.
You're now creating. You're being an innovator. You're starting. You're not going, I'm going to follow this because the last shop did it. No, I'm going to do it this way because I believe this is the way. This is what. So that's why I believe nature is reality. There's nothing more than... That's it. Nature is reality. So I see it that way. When people are, you don't believe in this? And also, you're going to hell. I was like, well, thank you. Like, goddamn.
That's right.
Like, whoa. I just came off the back with that. You know, and for people that are praising themselves so highly and believing something, they're so judgmental when we're supposedly the non-believing and all this, but we're accepting of each other. Yeah. We're from totally different cultures.
Absolutely.
And we're sitting here figuring out how much dope shit we have in common.
Oh.
How much shit we have alike
or think alike. I'd be surprised how much you have in common with anybody.
Anybody. If you gave the time
to talk. And you listen.
Yeah.
You probably get that a lot because, I mean, when you couldn't hear me, you hear everything.
You're a therapist.
They hear everything.
You're a therapist to an extent.
I do that. When I get my barber, I let it go, man. I'm like, I come out teary-eyed.
I open up, man.
Have people opened up to you like that? I'm notorious for that.
I've had, like, super emotional points with my clientele. I've like, cried while doing hair, like, straight up. Like, like, hearing other people's stories and feeling other people's energy.
It's fucking crazy.
You know, and there's been, like, plenty of moments where it's, like, I feel like sometimes I have certain clients that literally, they just come to me to talk.
To be a friend.
You know, there's definitely certain ones that when they come and sit in the chair, like, I'm giving them a haircut, but I know that, like, it's going to be more than that.
Yeah.
Like, we're going to be talking about life creation, like, choices, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I think everybody looks for guidance in a certain way, and I think especially in what we do, the blessing is that, like, you go to a therapist, you know you're going there for help.
Yeah.
You're going for somebody to figure you out.
So you block a little.
So there's still like
that wall. Yeah.
Whereas like me, I'm a person. You know, I'm just a person.
Yeah.
And I happen to have a friendly relationship, but I'm not interconnected with their entire circle.
Yeah.
So it makes this like this kind of sweet spot.
Yeah.
To it's where the safe zone. It's a total safe zone.
Yeah. Because I'm not judging them no matter what.
Yeah.
You know, like it's at the end of the day, I'm gonna give them my sound feedback, my sound like ideas of what I think is like, you know, maybe right, wrong, or the path that they want to choose. But it's not biased on any means. It's just from me knowing them as a person from the years that I've been doing their hair for 30 minutes to an hour and a half at a time. And I mean, I've seen awesome creations happen in the chair.
Yeah, man. Yeah,
absolutely.
Because when awesome. I'm in, like, I have, like, some of my close friends are barbers. Like, my friend owns Freshly Faded.
Yeah.
Derek, he's one of my good friends. We know each
That's
other.
That's the one right off Elkhorn Boulevard next to the
Sonic across, yeah, the Sonic right across the street. Yeah.
That place is sick.
Yeah, so he's been a friend of mine since we were in high school, man. Mm-hmm. So, and then I know the girls from Studio NN, Cindy, and then
I don't know anybody from over there.
Yeah, so they're down, I think, on, fuck, what was the street? I know they're in Mission Hills, I think.
Yeah.
But they went to high school with me, and you see all your friends from high school, and we're all creating businesses.
Yeah, all creating, doing something.
And doing their thing, you know, it's dope to, like, be like, oh, shit, like, you know.
Yep.
And a lot of them know me from being, you know, like, the hood guy. Like, I was, you know, doing business. Rough, yeah. I was a drug dealer. I collected money. I was the guy that went and Mystery. Made sure you paid who you owed, you know.
You
and,
paid your dues.
You know, I was that guy. You know, like I said, I never hide my past because that's who I am. I don't hide it where, like, oh, I did stuff. No, that's what I did. I collected. If you didn't pay, I'd break your fucking legs, and that's it.
Yeah.
Pretty simple, like, plain and simple. That's what I did. Mm-hmm. Why? Because I needed to survive. I left my home at 14, my mom's house. You know, not because it was rough. My mom took care of us the same. Like, how you're saying, I made those bad choices.
Oh, yeah. No, it wasn't forced upon me.
I thought I was a man. You know, like, you think,
like,
you're,
I'm out.
I'm a man. And then you really realize really quick you weren't. I was God damn, I'm not a man.
Like, this is
because I slept outside. I slept in the street and really realized, like, shit, I'm not a man. I'm in the fucking street. Like, I'm sleeping outside. Like, you know, so it made me think of crazy shit, you know, which is funny because a lot of people have a tendency to blame other people for putting themselves. You know, it's like, dude, I'm pretty sure you had the same choice that we had, and we just chose to make these dumb decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's nobody's forcing your hand. And don't get me wrong, people get put in bad situations, but you still have a choice.
A choice, yeah. And I feel like that's when you start realizing, like, oh, I can start creating. I can start being, because you're not as influenced. Like, sometimes when you're, like, with parents the whole time and their influence and their beliefs there, you're kind of closed-minded.
Yeah.
When you get the opportunity to do what we did and kind of left earlier, you kind of see all types of views of life, and you're like, oh, shit, like, whoa, like, I guess it wasn't like this, like, you know what I mean?
It's never black and white.
You know, and sometimes it's a blessing in disguise when you're just like, oh, shit.
I think it's the greatest blessing to learn your limits, to, you know, I mean, just make those mistakes.
Yeah,
you know, I think you live a lot more when you tend to make a little rougher decisions here and there. Yeah. And, like, I think it makes every person, the man or woman that they are.
Yeah.
You know, I think sometimes when things are just handed or, you know, everything's easy, it's just you're coasting.
Yeah.
Whereas when you're put up against a wall or you're put in a situation, you really learn who you are.
Yeah. And I think that's why we like the wilderness.
Yeah.
It's a test. When you go backpacking and just all you have is in your backpack and you go into the middle of the woods and
you're like, this is all I got.
This is all you got. You know, and I think a lot of people, if they got more in touch with that, like, okay, let's just, because I told them, I was like, you know what we're taking is a backpack, right? It's whatever fits in your backpack.
Yeah, that's it.
That's it. Like, you don't get to take your tech. I'm going to take my iPad.
Yeah.
You don't get to take your damn iPad.
What are you going to do?
There is no iPad. There's no signals. There's nothing. Like,
come on, bro.
You did say that.
I didn't say that.
Yeah, you did.
I said it'll be hard to live without it.
Yeah, he's like, I'm going to take my iPad.
Really? He
wanted to take his damn iPad. So when you're out there, when you go camping, do you go, like, extreme camping, or do you take that inflatable thing, or is
it
just back?
I mean, it depends on what I'm doing. Lately, I've been definitely way more into just off-roading. So, yes, I have, like, a lot of equipment with me, but I'm away from everything.
Yeah.
So it's like, I mean, I lay down the seats. I have an inflatable mattress.
Nice.
I get comfortable. Like, yeah, I got a table that I lay out. I got, like, a stove, all that kind of stuff. But I've done, like, straight-up backpacking where it's, like, you have everything on you, and that's it. But I like doing that because, for one, I love driving. I grew up racing, and it's like, I just absolutely enjoy it.
Yeah.
And it's like, when you're smashing off on these roads, and it's like, that's the test to me is, like, you know, you say going out there with just your backpack, nothing else. Me, I'm going out with my car. Nobody's coming up to say, I have no service.
Yeah.
Like, there's
if anything happens, that's
on me. So it's like, when I'm driving out there and I got, like, you know, just me and my buddy's car and, like, our food, I'm like, well, this is what we got for 3 days, a week, or whatever, how long we choose to be out there.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah,
and you definitely learn, like,
And you're just going nuts, right? You guys are trying. Challenging yourself. Every new time you go, like, I'm going to try this shit. It might fail, but I'm going to go for it.
Absolutely. Like, I mean, there's definitely this one point we're coming up on this, like, single-lane dirt road. And there's this truck coming down this way. And, like, they kind of inch up on the side, but there's not much room on the side. And it's, like, cliff on the other side.
Oh, hell no.
And, and I'm like, I'm going to go for it. My buddy's like, what? I'm like,
let me out.
I just drop into second gear. The car pops on the side of the edge of the cliff. The tire's kind of catching and starts sliding. Then I just drop the gear down, pop back onto the road after that.
I'd be like, stop. Dude, stop the car. I'm getting off.
The car that's coming out is just like just signaling. They're like, stop. No. And I'm like, I mean, we passed this car with like a millimeter.
Oh, hell
like,
yeah.
Just like right there, just like doing it.
Look for that rush, that adrenaline.
You didn't even hesitate. You said we're going for it.
Oh, like, no.
I think if you're going to do that, you have to be that mentality.
That confident. No, you have to be, right? You have to be committed 100%.
You can't second guess it. No, and it's like, it was like, I was already doing it, and I'm like, we're going for it. Like, it wasn't like, we're going for it, then
his decision was made.
Like, this
made,
is happening. It's already been made.
That's so fucked up. I'd have been like, let me out this fucking car.
I freak out
when we're going like 80 on the freeway.
Yeah.
Is it not a trip then when you're not driving, everything seems scarier?
Oh, yeah, it's terrible. You're not in control.
It's like, fuck this, man. I'm like, Joe, slow down. He's all,
we're going. I'm driving this car with this girl. It's my buddy's ex-girlfriend. And you know those people that drive like this? And they're like, yeah.
That's me. That's me.
I'm like, look forward.
That's
like,
me. I didn't go to the steering wheel and talking.
When me and Randy were first come down the hill in Big Bear,
because
I'm scared of heights a bit, you know? So you're just coming down those turns. And for someone that likes to drive, I'm sure he loves coming down that fucking...
Yeah.
Because it's a cool road. It's like, if you're into like really driving and you know how to drive, it's a cool road to go because it's really turning. It gives you cool turns and challenges. But there's points where you're like at the very end and you just see the fucking cliff and you're like...
I'm like,
like, hold it all like this. I'm like, oh, fuck. Like, I hate flying. I'm terrified of flying.
What?
Terrified, dude.
I mean, I get it. You're flying in a giant steel tube.
Dude, I'm like sitting there the whole time, like, just stiff. By the time we get to where we're going,
I'm so tired.
I'm just like, oh, fuck, I need to relax. But I can't. We've flown to Hawaii, all over Mexico. I've been on fucking a shitload of planes, and it's the same feeling every time.
Yep. Every time.
The same feeling every time. It never changes. I'm terrified every single time. I'm panicked every single time.
Yeah.
When we went to Houston for the fight, Bolivita's fight, they sent us on the, you know, the small planes that go from here to LA, they cruise at 10,000 feet.
You feel everything in those.
And that one wasn't bad because we were cruising at 10,000 feet and I could see things and it seemed normal.
Yeah.
It's like, cool. Then they're like, okay, we're switching planes. And Brandon's like, oh, we're just switching to a bigger plane because it's a longer flight.
Wrong.
We went in that small-ass plane in fucking Texas.
Yeah.
And then it started moving. When it went up to the 30,000 or whatever it went.
Turbulence in Texas.
Oh, my fucking God. And I'm like, no, this isn't normal. And she's like, no, it's normal. And I'm like, fuck no, this isn't normal. Yeah. Like, we were like,
Those small planes, you feel everything.
We're going to die. And I'm like, this isn't normal. She's like, it's normal. And some asshole next to me is like, it's not normal. he whispers at me, like, it's not normal.
That's fucked up.
Like, why would you scare someone? I'm legitimately freaking out.
Yeah.
And I'm like, holding on to her. Like, I'm like a 3-year-old, like, Penny. She's this big. So I'm like, grabbing her arm. It's the most terrifying thing in the world to me. But like you said, it's because we don't have control.
Yeah.
We don't have that control. Everything else we do, I'm sure you feel the same way. You have control.
Oh, yeah.
When you have those scissors. Scissors in your hand, it's your control.
I mean, this is like a common joke amongst, I don't know, my crew or family, friends, like whatever. Yeah. It's like, I like being the leader of things. I like being in control of everything. It's like, I like so much control. I don't even want to drive an automatic car. Like, it's like I drive a stick shift because I like being in complete control.
In control,
it's just, I don't know, it's bizarre. Just, I like having the reins.
Yeah, that's like, to me, like when it comes to cars now, I used to not like to drive.
Oh, yeah?
I know how to drive. My uncle showed me how to drive when I was like 4, so I know how to drive. It's just, I didn't like to drive because I didn't trust
everyone else. Yeah.
So it was like a big, like, fucking thing for me. Like, I wouldn't want to drive. Like, no, I don't want to drive. I'm like, I wouldn't drive.
Yeah.
And then I was like, you know something? I can't keep doing this shit. I'm just going to start fucking driving. And yeah. I got back to just driving. I went to Big Bear. Like, you would not catch me driving the freeway from here to, like, Del Mar.
Oh, that's crazy.
Like, I just didn't want to drive. Like, I was just like,
I can drive from here to the tip of South America.
Like, I was just like, oh, man, I can't fucking do it.
Like, goal of mine.
Like,
that would be dope, man.
Dude, like, I want to get in my car, and I want to start here and get down to the southern end of South America. Like, that's like an adventure goal. You have some
crazy
right
snow at the very tip of Argentina. Oh,
yeah.
And
Chile and everything.
Yeah, you're going to get that fucking...
That's adventure, like, vision goals.
So, we're thinking of going to Peru.
Oh, yeah?
To Machu Picchu. Because I'm all into the ruins, and I'm all into that stuff. Like, I've been to the pyramids in Mexico City.
Yeah, I just got back from Tulum and saw the Mayan ruins down there.
Tulum, nice. Yeah, Tulum's nice. Did you go... Just Tulum, or you go to Chichen Itza, Cobá?
We just went to Tulum, but we also went through this area called Sican and then Punta Allen. And they're both, like, really small, like, fisherman town. Like, nothing out there. We rented a Jeep and just, like, started smashing off-road out there.
Nice.
Stayed in a treehouse right on the beach. Saw 13-foot alligators, swam with turtles.
Right. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah,
that's
it. It was awesome.
Well, when you go down there, man, there's jaguars. Or
yeah,
any,
jaguars down
all
there.
That shit is there, man. And they tell you, like, they're there. So you go run into some damn jaguars. Like, we went to Playa del Carmen, and we stayed in Cancun, but we went to Tulum, went to Chichen Itza, we went to Cobá, we went to a bunch of the pyramids there. And then in Mexico City, we went to Teotihuacan.
Yeah.
So, you know, like, it's my culture, it's my roots. So seeing things that...
See it and you feel it.
It's like, oh, shit. Like, when you see it firsthand, like, Tulum is impressive because it's right on the beach and you get the beauty of the beach. But it's not massive.
Yeah.
When you go to Teotihuacan in Mexico City,
yeah,
that fucking thing is massive.
It's
like,
huge.
It's massive. You're like, how did they build this shit?
Aliens.
Like, dude, it's just so fucking big. It's just like, it just looks incredible when you
did
see
it. Did
you get
some sort of feels, though?
Yeah, man.
When I go to Mexico and I feel some.
Like when Brandy,
I'm from there, you know? Like,
when we were in Chichen Itza, she was super sick. Because, you know, it's humid and then they put you in the fucking... AC buses and shit,
and
then it's humid,
and
then you're in and out. So she got really sick. And in Chichen Itza, there's these pillars. Like, when you're going towards the observatory, they have this big observatory. And when she walked through the pillars, she's like, oh, man, I feel fucking great. I don't feel sick. I don't feel... So you just get a different vibe when you're in these things that are, like, so ancient. Like, you're like, whoa, like...
I get the feels, man.
These motherfuckers were way more advanced than we were because they get certain things. Our buildings get knocked down by fucking air.
Oh, yeah. Like, these have been around.
Like, these motherfuckers have been there forever, and they're still standing. Like, oh, shit. Like, and then in the Mayan culture, it goes all the way down to Guatemala.
Yeah.
And it's only been 10% excavated.
Oh, yeah.
So it's only
10%. Still underground.
In jungles. Yeah. Like, there's so many things that they still haven't uncovered in the Mayan ruins. 10%, that's all. And there's so many. Like, Palenque. There's so much shit from fucking... Mexico to Guatemala, stuff like that. I'm really into, like, I want to go to Chaco Canyon in New Mexico.
I'm not familiar.
So dope. Like, the ruins are built into the rock bed, into the canyons, and you see the Grand Canyon, all that type of mountain thing. So it looks really cool. They built into the side of the mountain, and it looks fucking dope. And
that's epic.
That's so crazy. Like, how do you build that, you know? And it's a drive away, so I don't have to fly all crazy. I don't have to go all nuts. So now when we get back to the whole hairstyling and stuff and all that, is it something that, like, you wake up every morning just, like, happy to do? Like, just sometimes you get like, fuck.
Everything goes in waves. I feel blessed every morning waking up, being able to go and create something that's furthering another, like, notch in the belt, another, like, step towards, you know, the lifestyle that I want.
Yeah.
Just like any other thing you do, there's days you go in and you're like, I wish I was at the beach or chilling or doing something, for sure. But it's more so like, I always know that every day that I go in, everything that I do, even like this, it's just one more step towards the lifestyle, the life I want to create, the vision I want to create for others.
Absolutely.
You know, so like, ultimate vision is creating this platform for all these stylists to come in and learn through, we do education, all that stuff, and really creating success for all these other stylists. Yeah. Like, my goal is to have 1,000 stylists that work underneath me and love their life. They love working with us. They love exactly what they're doing. And, you know, that's what I'm working towards. Yeah. When is that going to happen? I don't know.
Do you plan to, like, open different locations? Absolutely. And stuff like that?
You know, we have our location right now. We're looking at more locations currently. Yeah. You know, we've been open for a little over a year and a half now. And it's like, now it's time for the next step. We have plenty of people that want to work with us. We have the capabilities of doing it.
Yeah.
It's just about stamping it out and making it happen. But, yeah, I mean, some days I cruise in and I'm like, pff. But the funny thing is like, I can wake up.
Yeah.
And I can have a day where I'm starting slow, but as soon as I start working and I start getting after it,
yeah,
it's a total shift. Like every single time without fail, like, you know, a client will buzz in and it's like even up to them coming in the door, I'm like, man, I wish I was like doing this with my lady, taking my dog to the park, or I was like, you know, working on this thing for the business, or I was, you know, trying to grow something else other than just that client right in front of me. And then they walk in the door and all of a sudden, like, they inspire me.
Yeah.
Like my client says something.
I was gonna say, like, sometimes it's that person that, like, you have a shitty day, you're starting, you're like, fuck, man, and then that person just lives it up, and then it's like, oh, okay, you get back in the groove of like, this is why I do it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I get that sometimes with some of my clients here and some of the people that I like to teach. It takes a bit, but you know, to me, I've been doing this so long, that's why I created the podcast, because this actually brought me back into my boxing. Like, it gave me more passion.
Gave me more fuel to it.
Because I'm hearing all these stories from everyone else. Yeah. Like, and it gives me motivation. Like, damn, they're the same thing. They struggled with their business. They've been grinding. It's the same thing. And they're so happy about it. And they're so grateful about it. Like, why?
We're blessed, dude. Like, so little, like, statistics that have recently been shared with me as well. Is like, so there's 30 million business owners. Yeah. In the U.S., 30 million. 27 million of those business owners only are doing it with themselves. Like, you know, do you run this place solely on yourself?
Yeah.
Do you have anybody else?
No.
So, like, you're still part of an elite. There's billions of people in the U.S.
Yeah.
But then, like, when you have somebody working for you, there's, like, what, only 3 million business owners? Like, What I'm getting at is that just the fact that you decided to step out the box, like, you're part of an elite group.
Yeah.
You're a part of this.
It takes a lot to take that step and actually do it. Because like Jose was saying, everybody says hope. But
no,
from hoping to doing
it's making action.
Whole, even the podcast, we would start off as a joke. And then, like, look, here we are. It took a while, but I mean, we forward to it. You know?
You guys are working on this together. And it's like, just having that kind of leadership to where it's like, you know, you guys come up with an idea.
Yeah,
you're doing it.
And when we first did it, like, it was being half-assed. Remember, I would tell you, like, no, I'm not gonna do nothing until it's 100% right.
Yeah,
like, we will know. We will have everything. We tried so many trials.
There's some.
We did audio ones just by themselves first. Like, I couldn't get the audio right because we had shitty microphones.
It evolved, man.
And it started going into, like, where we finally got it, like, this system. And then we were finally happy with it, and I was like, we're doing the first show. Once I figured out the whole thing, like, the sponsorships for the microphone, like, a lot of stuff was just sponsored. Like, I had people.
We had to invest.
We all put money, people sponsored, people were like, it was trials and errors. Like, we have equipment still there that was our first idea, and it didn't work out that way. So we kept pushing, and then everybody that was involved in it, you know, started in there just being me and him.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, oh, well, teach me the back part. I'll do the back part.
Yeah.
You know, in the first shows, he's jumping up and down. So then I was like, okay, well, we'll put the camera and the mic there. So now he could be on it.
It's hard not to be part of the conversation, man.
So it just starts like, okay, well, let's keep evolving it. Now he has a way where people can see who he is.
Yeah.
Because people probably want, who's this voice in the background?
It's echoey. It's all like,
this is Julio.
Yeah, I'm just a ghost right now.
Yeah,
we're still a little ghost in the screen.
Yeah, so it's like, who the hell is that guy? Like, so then I was like, today will be the first show I put him on there.
Yeah.
And I was like, look, so we put the little box, and he's like, oh, I got a microphone.
Ooh.
Yeah, he was like,
oh, I can't handle this power, man.
He was like, oh, man, I got a microphone. But it's like, now that's what we're going to be doing, you know, like, if it's four of us, it's four of us, like two, one.
Yeah.
You know, the one-on-one conversations, we've done two people. We try to do the group one. We're about to do, on New Year's, this is going to be us, the original guys that we're going to be.
OG Chris.
So the New Year's, we're going to do it and just talk about what happened the whole year, our experiences. And we're looking forward to stuff like that because it's just you and your buddies chopping it down about everything you did, everything that happened in the year, the people you've gotten to meet. And this is why I wanted to do it this way with guests, meeting new people, meeting, creating new friends, knowing things, knowing that, like, oh, if you ever were like, oh, I'm into boxing, I know somebody.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Expanding that network.
I know people that are doing stuff. You know what I mean? Sorry, guys.
You get blown up.
And then I was like, you know, this is what I want to do. You know, we've had different types of stuff from fighters, bartenders, hairstylists. On Thursday, we have a yoga instructor and stuff like that. You know what I mean? I'm just trying to go all over the place.
We all have things in common. Yeah. All of them.
And I've been sending constant messages to every type of person, fitness people, everything, makeup artists, everything. I just keep sending. Yeah. And whoever says yes is yeah. Whoever says no, who doesn't respond, if they respond later, whatever. It's just I'm going to keep pursuing interesting people.
Keep counting the paper.
And that's why I said, I was like, I don't care if you have one follower or a million. That's not the point right now. The point is for us to get to talk. And that's why the name was We Just Talking.
We're just talking.
I mean, the reason I said talking is because I wanted to hear like proper white guys say talking instead of talking. Like my lawyer.
Were you hoping I was gonna mess
up? I knew I was a man. He was like, ah, he's cool. He's gonna say talking. Yeah, but I'm like,
my, now, when we are talking, as we commence the show,
I wanted it to be like, it's still a little hood, but we get to be ourselves in this. And that's what I want to show people from Instagram or your fans right now, or new fans you might get out of this, or new clients, or anything we could get out of this to see who you are. So they could experience like, because we put this on YouTube, so it's always on there now.
Yeah.
Once it's on
it's
YouTube, it's there forever. Nice. So now whoever you want people to see, like, oh, check out this thing we were doing. It was funny. It was fun. We enjoyed it. We were all having a blast. No one was, you know what I mean? It's to see who's really natural and who can't be natural in a way. Like, it gets, you get to bring out the natural in people.
Yeah.
Like, or that's my goal, at least, to be like, oh, I get to have a conversation.
I think that's the best thing you can do for any, I mean, of course, it's conversation. It's all, like, of course, we still are inevitably trying to build our businesses and our brands. But the biggest shift that I think anybody can make for any of their business or any of their brand, dude, just be you.
Yeah.
100%. Like, 100%. Because, like, once you allow that transparency, that vulnerability, you put it all out on the line, it's relatable. People get it. Like, nobody wants to be sold to.
Yeah.
You know, nobody wants like a pitch.
Yeah.
Like they just want to feel like they're doing business with somebody that they believe in, something that they stand behind.
Yeah.
I think there's a major shift in our culture right now. Like everybody's so sick of this like mass chain production of everything.
Yeah.
They're sick of the spiel. They're sick of like the slogan. They're sick of, they want to feel like they're a part of a community. We get so locked up like right here. Scrolling through stuff,
and everyone does it.
Oh yeah, I do it too.
Yeah, you know? Like, it's so crazy.
But when you get to sit down with a stranger, and experience who they are, you get to experience what they're about. Like, it brings life into you.
Yeah,
you
know? It's taking it back to me. It's like just back to just being human.
Yeah,
without needing. Totally. I mean, we are putting it, and we are using technology, but we're using technology to show people that you can still be human behind your technology, behind your Instagram. There are still human beings behind that, and you get to experience that.
Absolutely.
So that's why I think the more we're doing these shows, the more people are seeing it and they're excited to see like, oh, cool, we're just there. I get to see this person, or like if they looked you up on anything, now you have another.
Well, we all get these personas, like even as a person that's putting their own Instagram or their own Facebook up, like
you still portray yourself in a certain way.
You're selling yourself.
And you're also showing
yourself.
And you're showing your best pics and everything.
Yeah,
so this is like,
But then, like I said, how dope is it now that if they look you up, there's one little video that shows you just talking,
just talking.
One of my clients, he comes down from LA or San Francisco, actually, like. Once every few months, and every time he's in town, he makes sure to get his haircut because he really enjoys the time. And he's like asking me how I'm doing, and it's like I portray myself in a certain way on Instagram, Facebook, like whatever. And he's like looks like life's awesome, things are crushing. I'm like, you know what? Honestly, I had like a crazy breakdown last week. Like, I was just in a funk. I was like, things were just pissing me off. Like whatever was getting at me, and it like I saw him light up. He's like, dude, me too. Like I don't know what's going on. And being real with someone, like I think. we're all so accustomed, like, especially in our culture, like, opposed to other people's, like, they're like, how are you doing? You're like, oh, I'm fine, I'm great. Well, really, it's like,
communicate, open up. Like,
yeah, open up. That's like, a big thing. It's okay to not be okay.
Yeah,
for a minute,
yeah, that's,
know?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not saying be down all the time. I'm just saying be honest.
Be honest, yeah. Just let, if you're gonna cry, cry. If you're gonna say yes, cry.
Yeah,
I mean, he's laughing because, one time I came in and he was listening to some Mexican music that, you know, was kind of sad.
I'm
like,
heartstring.
And I was like, hey, man, do you want to cry? And he's like, no. I was like, I know, dude. I know. Just let it go.
It's okay.
He's all, I don't want to fucking cry.
He was like, wanted me to break down so bad. He wouldn't let it go for a second, but like a week.
And I'm all like, dog, just cry, dog.
I call it letting it rip.
Yeah.
You know, I let it rip. When crying, it puts a better tone to it.
Let
like,
it rip.
I'm not crying. I'm going to let it rip.
I was like, and I would walk by him and I was like, I feel you right here. Like, and he'd be like, what are you talking
soda,
about?
Like, go for it,
man. Yeah, I was like, I'm here for you, dog. Like, let it go. Because you know, those songs are traditionally what guys listen when they break up with their girls.
Oh, yeah.
They start crying. And, and he wanted to act like he's a machine. And I was like, yo, I cry all the fucking time.
Yep.
My big ass be crying. I'm like, anything sad I watch on TV, I'm like, God damn, I'm crying. I'm like, oh, I'm over here tearing up and shit. They're like, what's wrong? I was like, nothing, leave me alone. But I cried in the fucking Lion King. Real shit. I've cried when, honestly, I've cried on Facebook watching the shit that happens in Syria when you see these little fucking kids, man. And still, we see it as, like, it's really nothing. Like, it's just a Facebook clip. And to me,
that's
not. You know, that's real. That's really happening to that little kid. And then I grab my nephew, and I can know, like, fuck, I would, oh, man, I'd lose everything if I lost him or any, you know. And it, and to me, it's just a reality check. Like, look how blessed you fucking are. And we're here crying about a dollar.
We're all blessed, man. Like, just the statistics on, and I heard this from this guy, Gary Vee, the statistics on being a human being. You hit the fucking lotto, dude.
Yeah.
Like, just...
Yeah.
Being a person, out the gate, you're already winning.
Yeah,
you're already winning.
Absolutely.
And it's up to you to win more or less. And, you know, people be put in circumstances, but it's like, you got to remember, like, you see that guy on the street that's, like, asking for a dollar or, like, whatever it is. Like, sure, he can be a beggar, but you don't know the story that led him to there. You don't know what it is. And it's like, you see those people in Syria or, like, wherever it is. It's like, dude,
like,
these are people.
Two episodes ago, we had a breast cancer survivor.
Yeah.
The girl. And
I was looking at that.
Dude, her... Her outlook on life was just dope. Like, how happy she is, like, how she's seeing it, how she's taking that as a blessing. Like, not a lot of people would take cancer as a blessing.
Oh, no. See, like, my father, he passed away when I was 14, and he passed away from cancer as well. Or, I mean, she's luckily not passed away, but it's like, sure, it was terrible. It was, like, really tough, for sure. But, like, it was such a blessing at the same time because... I got showed such value of life, like, of how short it can be at such a young age.
Exactly,
It was like, and that's how I think things kind of spun differently for me as a kid. I've always been a person that, like, no regrets. Like, put it all on the table, whatever I'm doing, 100% in, because there might not be a tomorrow. You know, he left me with, like, these words that I live my life by.
Yeah.
You know, there's two dates on a gravestone, and there's a dash right in between. That's how long life is. It's this long.
Yeah.
It's up to you to fill it with whatever you
want.
That's
pretty deep. That's pretty good.
That's dope.
It's up to you to fill it with whatever you want. And
calm
like,
down, Julio.
Breaking
shit.
Breaking
shit. He's like, fuck this. He's going to flip.
Tearing up now.
Yeah, but no, that is dope. That's like, that's a
good.
Dope dad, man.
But it's just, it just gives you perspective. And, you know, I think, like we were talking about with struggle and all those kind of things, it puts more perspective. The more struggle you have, the more perspective you have.
Yeah.
And, you know, that girl with the cancer, she has more perspective than I think anybody can know. You know, you got life put in front of her. And my lady was actually battling a cancer of her own, and you know, she's in remission now. And like, I'll tell you what, it puts a mirror up on your life. It puts everything right in front of you, and it's like, it really makes you think, like, why am I getting ticked off by somebody cutting me off or like something, like whatever going on. It's like, dude, like, just make life as good as you can with what's in front of you, and create whatever you can.
And that's something I've been really trying to work on, because I used to be really, really aggressive, like angry. Like anybody said something to me, it was quick, bow, just boom, just floor them, like it was over. And I started thinking, like, well, why? Like, why? My thing was, if you didn't show me respect, like verbally, I'm going to get my fucking respect physically.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to show you that I am more than you. Yeah. And that was my mindset when I was younger. Yep. That if you didn't fucking respect me verbally or just showed me respect, I would go fucking, like, really?
Yeah.
I'm going to show you right now who the fuck I am.
Yeah.
And then I started learning, like, I don't need that.
No.
I don't need your fucking respect. If you don't want to give it to me, then fuck you, yeah, man. There's so many other people in this fucking world.
There's plenty of people.
I don't need to prove shit to you. Like, you know, it took me a minute to realize.
Like, that's something that I think can be humbling at times. When people don't show you respect, when people are being aggressive, when people are dogging on your business or dogging on what you're doing, they're hating, like, they're whatever.
Yeah.
Me, I just feel for them. I'm like, dude, I'm sorry. Like, whatever's going on you, like, that sucks.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
For you to put that much energy towards me, a negative condensation towards me, that means you got your own issues that you're battling with. You know, like me getting, I started, how we grew our business was through my Instagram for the most part. And I had barbers hating on me because I'm not a barber, I'm a stylist.
Yeah.
But I'd hashtag barber and like all this, and I'd hashtag fade because it gets better awareness.
Yeah.
And I'd have barbers like, you aren't even a barber, you shouldn't even have a straight razor. He's like dogging on me, this and that. And I'm like, dude, I have much respect for you. You're a killer barber. Like, you crush it, man. And I just killed him with kindness. I was like, I'm not trying to say I'm a barber. I'm just saying, like, this is maybe a style that I'm doing or whatever. Yeah. And he was trying to hate. And I'm like, dude, like, you can crush it on your own. You don't have to hate on me to do it. Like, you don't have to step on that.
Absolutely.
And it's like, at the end of the day, it's like, lead it with positivity. Otherwise, what's the point?
That's the point. Yeah. And that's what I started learning with time. Like, I don't need everyone's approval. Like, you know, approval. Like, I started learning, like, okay, I am tough. Not everyone needs to know I'm tough. Like, okay, stop. Like, you know what I mean? It comes from understanding that. And I love that I got to grow from that.
Yeah.
You know, I got to grow from that. And I got to get the experience to actually be calm. Like, where people think I'm going to snap, I'm like, you're good, man. Like, don't worry about it.
I used to be quite the hothead myself as well at times. Yeah. You know, he's asked me if I had any experience with boxing in the past, and only experience has been out in real life.
Yeah.
And it's like, my initials are WKO, and like all my friends knew me as Kenny, and they actually called me KO because it was the knockout. Like, somebody pissed me off, that'd be it, knockout. And it wasn't a high point.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I used to think it was cool, and then I started realizing it was stupid. Yeah.
I realize that there's always someone better than you. Someone will knock you the fuck out. Someone's going to come and kick your ass. And that's why boxing and combat sports are a very humbling experience. When you first get in there with someone that's just more superior than you, it just feels like, fuck, man. Like, like when we used to sit there with all the other fighters, and we used to sit there together, and we used to watch regular people, like, with no experience, try to spar. I'm like, yo, man, don't you feel like a god to these guys? Like, can you, like, what I could do to you like this, like, seconds, bro.
Absolutely.
And he would sit there and be like, that's a trip, right? Like, and I was like, but also remember, shit they do, we're a fool to what they can do.
Yeah.
Like, when you get an accountant, I can't do that. Or, like, when you get all these other crafts, and then you're like, shit, we're dorks to them. Like,
totally.
So it just evens out in everyone's situation. Everything that's what humbled me. Like, he could just crush me, and if we were doing something that took numbers or anything like that, or people
come
to my world, you know what I mean? And that's why I started
in the boxing room with you. I'm sure you'd show me a thing or two.
I started.
I set you behind a chair. I'm sure I'd show you.
Yeah, so that's where I started humbling that we could teach each other in everything we do. So to wrap this up, man, any last things to invite people to your guys' salon?
Yeah,
how can they reach you guys?
Well, you know, anybody that's looking for us at the salon, just check out foxandparlor.com. Like, we got a website on there, but to keep most current, like, look on Instagram and Facebook, Fox and Parlor Facebook page. You'll find it, Fox and Parlor Salon. I'm personally WKO on Instagram with underscores in between. But, you know, just make your own decisions. Check out what we're doing. And that's pretty much it. We're downtown. We're by appointment only, so you have to text or call us first.
Okay.
You have to book online. Like, there is not availabilities to just cruise on in.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's one of those things. You know, if you're looking for something special, you're looking for something more than a haircut, hit us up.
Yeah, man. Go check them out.
Yep.
We're going to shout out all our sponsors, CoinUp, Brandy, Eric the Lawyer.
We just call Eric the Lawyer.
So, yeah, everybody that hooked us up, Julio, he's on cam now. So
coming up in the world.
Julio. His new name, Julio. Julio's on the thing. So we want to thank you so much for coming, man, for stopping by. Great awesome show, man. I hope to have you back on.
I'll be back.
Next time we'll get all the rest of the staff, if we could possibly get more of the girls in here so we
could
talk.
Oh, we could even host it at my salon.
Absolutely, man. Oh, yeah, our stuff is mobile, so we can move this around.
Yeah, we could definitely do that.
Yeah, man, and we'll go down there and hit you guys up, man. This was an awesome show. I want to thank everybody that watched, and it'll be on YouTube in a few hours, like 3-4 hours.
Cool.
And then we could share it. The Facebook one will be automatically on as soon as we cut off, so people can see it there. But thank you, guys.
All right, babe. And